Welcome to the Christian Woman Leadership Podcast, where we hope to inspire you to embrace your God-given gifts, skills, and passions in order to lead with confidence. We want you to remember that you are fearfully and wonderfully made in the image of God, and you are fully loved by Him.
You have been designed on purpose by God with unique gifts and passions in order to love and lead those around you. I'm your host, Esther Littlefield, a pastor's wife, business owner, mom, and writer.
And I'm Esther's co-host, Holly Kane. I'm a wife, mom, and business owner. I also write at hollykane.org, where I focus on my passion for women's ministry.
Together, we chat about important issues that Christian women leaders face. In addition, we interview other women just like you who lead in various roles, from church to community to business. Through this podcast, we offer you encouragement, tools, and resources to help you on your leadership journey. We are so glad you're here with us. Welcome to today's episode. I am here with Holly, and we are talking about what to do when you want to quit. So, hey, Holly, how are you doing today?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I am doing good, other than the fact that I forgot we were going to record today. So,
No worries.
So, we have been in this series on wellness. We've been talking about staying healthy as a leader, and we really went into depth on that in episode 48 and 50. Mm-hmm. And some of our guests have talked about that too. But let's face it, sometimes we can be doing all the right things and we can be staying healthy. We can be really being on track with a lot of these areas of wellness, but we can still have days when we want to quit, right? I mean, have you?
Oh, had definitely. That? All this week, pretty much.
Right. Okay. So we decided to talk about this one because I think the reality is that both of us have had recent experiences where we kind of have been struggling. And I think it's helpful for you as a listener to just know that we're real people and that we have days when we want to quit and give up. And a lot of us are running a business or we're working full time. A lot of us are involved in ministry life and even just having a family, being married, having kids. In all of these scenarios, there are days and situations where we kind of have moments where we feel like quitting. So I thought we would just talk about it today, and maybe we can start by talking about a little bit of our own experiences and when we've experienced this ourselves, and then maybe we'll talk about what to do and how to handle it when you're in that situation. Okay?
Yeah. So I think this is an important conversation, and I'm glad that we're having it. I think it's very timely. So
yeah. Okay. So Holly, have you had some experiences when you've wanted to quit any of those things we just talked about?
Oh gosh. Yes. I'm laughing because I'm pretty sure that Esther is the only reason I made it through this week.
As we mentioned on a previous episode, we are supportive to each other during these moments. So,
I mean, specifically in business, I just have been lately sort of feeling like not really good enough, like imposter syndrome. I'm certainly not meeting my own expectations, things that I had hoped for my business or to, I guess maybe to grow as quickly as I would like to. I also get easily distracted by what everyone tells me I should be doing. And it really makes me feel like I'm just so under par that I feel like I'm just not where I should be. And it makes me want to quit because if I'm not excelling, if I'm not doing really well, or I'm doing all of the things that other people consider baseline, then I must be doing something very wrong. So those sort of things have been kind of playing in my mind over the past, well, I mean, since I started a business really, but, but you know, more so and like stronger and louder over the past couple of weeks. And this past week, it was a lot more difficult. I just really let it get the best of me and didn't handle it super well, but,
we're going to talk about that.
I also didn't end up like throwing my hands up and just closing my business doors. So I'm glad that
that's a win.
Talked me off a ledge.
Awesome. Yeah.
And then another thing sort of recently is just sometimes with family and different things, I think it's mostly my own expectations of myself. I just get easily overwhelmed by all the things I feel like I should be doing as far as parenting. I have a lot of big emotions about things, and so those things kind of like exhaust me. And the pressure that I put on myself to parent correctly, like how am I screwing up my kid? Like I don't have a savings for his future therapy. He's going to be totally screwed up. Other kids are going to think he's weird. Is someone bullying him? Am I giving him the right amount of risk so that he can learn responsibility? Is he totally screwing up responsibility? Is he going to be living in my basement in like 40 years? Like, these are all the things that I worry about and I overanalyze when it comes to just small things that happen.
Yeah.
And it makes me want to quit. And that sounds really like, no, I'm not going to leave my family. But, you know, it makes you feel like, if none of these little things that I'm doing or the work that I'm trying to do is enough, then I'm just going to stop trying. So yeah, that's kind of how I felt. So that's as real as you're going to get.
We're getting real on this podcast today. If you've never felt this way, maybe just turn off the podcast now, because I don't know if it makes sense for you to keep listening.
Going to keep getting real up in here. Yeah.
Okay, I will share about some of mine, right? Because I've had those times too. So
I want to hear it.
So Holly and I have different personalities, but I have very high expectations of myself and of others, which is a good way to set yourself up for feeling like giving up on things, because you almost never hit the expectations of yourself, and other people definitely don't hit the expectations. Mm-hmm. So one of my recent experiences is ministry related. As I've shared before, my husband is a pastor and I'm involved in some of the things that happen at the church currently on a volunteer basis. And I just have had a couple situations recently where, you know, you hear people say things and that they are not said in any way to be critical or derogatory or really to hurt you, but when you are the person who is in a role where you are leading and you have invested a lot of time and energy and thought and prayer into some of the things that go on, it's really, really hard when you hear things that where people are just not satisfied. People are not happy. They're not satisfied. We need to be doing this and this and this and this and this and this. And again, my personality is like, yeah, I know that we should be doing all of those things, but it's not humanly possible to do all of those things. So I had one day where I was just really struggling and I sent a message to Holly and was like, I'm going to give up. I don't want to do this anymore. So that was rough. Mm-hmm. I've also experienced it in business. I had a time last year in my business where I was like maxed out on time, on energy, on mental overload. Client work was overwhelming. And I was just, and again, it was one of those times where I felt like I wasn't meeting anyone's expectations. And I was feeling overwhelmed in my own life. And so I was just like, okay, I'm done with this. Like, I'm going to go get a 9-to-5. I'm going to go, not that that's necessarily easier, but in my mind at the moment, it felt like that would be, the grass is greener situation. Yeah. And I wasn't going to be dealing with clients. I wasn't going to be dealing with all the pressure. So that was another situation.
Yeah.
And then more recently, like this past week, which is why, again, this is all like, some of this is very recent. So this is why this podcast episode is very applicable to our current situation. But if you listen to the podcast, then you know episode 47, when it first went out, had some errors in it. And it was my fault. I messed up on the editing and had some pretty significant sections where you could actually hear two conversations happening at the same time, which is A, not easy to listen to, and B, just makes no sense at all. And you can't actually hear what the person is saying. So I was kind of just like really bummed out about that. And I didn't necessarily want to quit the podcast, but I was like, oh my goodness, what is going on? So yeah, those are mine. And those are, and I would relate with you, Holly, too, on the family situation. I have definitely had times where I have felt like I cannot do this parenting thing. In fact, I have some blog posts about mom life in particular, parenting, and just when you just don't know what to do. So I'll probably drop the links to that in the show notes, because if that's an area for you,
yeah,
you know that you're not alone in that.
But I feel like too, like it doesn't necessarily have to be kids either. I know that there are sometimes it's very difficult when you feel like you can't please your parents, like they have really high expectations of you and whatever you do is just not good enough for them. So it's like, why continue trying if you're not happy with anything that I do?
Yes.
So while like for us, we're currently in the parent sort of mindset for that, there are a lot of other familial or close relationships that can feel that way. So don't count yourself out if you are not necessarily experiencing the parenting thing. If you have a relationship that feels like that, then that's what we're talking about. So
absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So the question is, what should we do or what do we do when we want to quit? You know, when we have these times where, just like you said, things feel like you can never do enough for what you're supposed to do. And it could also be, we didn't really mention this, but for the people who do work a 9-to-5, a regular job, there's probably, I know there's times when you might feel like quitting that role as well, because perhaps you can never please your boss. Maybe your boss is just never happy with what you do, and doesn't matter how hard you try, you can't please them, right? So what are some of the things that we can do, ways that we can deal with this reality of life and the fact that sometimes we deal with situations that lead us to want to quit? And I think the other question is, how do we know if we actually should stop doing something or not?
Yeah.
I think there's times, and we're going to talk about this, that there's times when you actually should quit something.
Yeah.
And then there's other times when you definitely shouldn't.
Well, and I think too, like when you're in the mix of all those feelings, everything feels like super important and kind of really intense. Mm-hmm. And so it's hard to decide what you should actually do with that. Like I have had times in past jobs where I've been like, okay, that's it. Like I'm walking out of here.
Yeah.
Don't call me. Don't talk to me again. I'm not coming back, you know? And you have to take that time to sort of really evaluate what's going on and what truly is happening. So,
yeah.
And that actually leads us into our first.
Good job. That leads you into our first.
That was a good segue. I didn't even mean to do that.
Yeah. So we're going to take you through some suggestions that we have on what to do. And again, not because we're experts, but because we have both experienced this recently and we feel like there's a few things that we have learned to do in these situations. So the first thing is to evaluate your situation. So a couple things you want to do. One is ask yourself, why am I feeling this way? Like, what is really triggering that feeling of wanting to quit? Mm-hmm. What are the actual facts in the situation? So I know, Holly, you mentioned big emotions, and we've talked about this before. Some of us are more driven by our emotions. Some are more driven by our gut feelings. Some are more driven by our thoughts. But really trying to get an objective handle on the facts of what's going on.
Yeah.
For me, when I had this situation recently with feeling this way with ministry, I had to have Holly help me evaluate the facts. I had to talk to a friend and help her sift through all of the things that were said and all the things that I was feeling to get down to, okay, what's the actual reality in this situation? And not be just obsessing over one thing that I heard that I was then focused on.
Right. And when you're kind of feeling like you're sort of ramping up to this anyway, someone could say something that's purely innocent or has no ulterior motive, and you put all kinds of filters on it. I'm not saying you necessarily, you in general. I do this. I put all kinds of filters on it. Well, they said this because da 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 da, and then I get all kinds of sassy attitude.
Yeah.
And that's how the narrative continues in my mind. And so when I ask the question or I talk to a friend about this, like, what are the facts? It helps me see that they probably didn't say this with all of that stuff that I put on it.
Yeah.
They probably said it out of ignorance, and that's not like negative ignorance. They just don't know the whole situation, or, you know, they said it out of, it was an off the cuff comment that really didn't mean anything that they didn't even think about. So like, this is a good question to ask yourself, like, what are the facts, and am I putting any sort of layers of emotion or layers of my own perspective or mindset on this.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I think you can look at, is there too much on your plate? Do you actually have too many commitments or more commitments than you should have at this time in this phase of your life? We've talked a lot about in past episodes that there's seasons of life and that different seasons of our lives, we can handle more or less based on what else is going on. And this is really different for each person too, because we all have different capacities in our own lives that mm-hmm. we can handle as well. And so that's something to evaluate. And I have to do that periodically for myself and just kind of give myself a check on what I actually have committed to. And I've done that even recently. Like, it doesn't matter how many times I tell myself this. I feel like quarterly I have to have another check in. What do I have going on? What have I said yes to? What is maybe something that needs to come off of my schedule for right now?
Yeah. And I feel like a really good way to sort of sort those things out is to just ask yourself, do you have your priorities straight? Are you doing what God has asked you to do? Are you working in the calling that He's given you? And we've talked about this on multiple episodes. And one of the ones most recently that I can think of are actually two, our episode with Brashana Miller, she talked about putting the expectation on God. So in other words, He's called me to do these things. I'm going to leave it in His hands to work all of those things out. I'm going to keep going towards that. And I'm going to just listen to Him as He directs me. And I'm putting the expectation on God, not on myself, because oftentimes, or at least for me, I know that the calling that I feel in on my own life is like way bigger than what I can actually do right now. So if I'm actually going to ever get there, He's going to have to be the one to do it anyway. So
yeah.
If I put the expectation on myself, I'm just going to be a puddle of emotions and I'm never going to get anywhere. The second episode that I think is really important is our most recent one with Merit Ansa. And she talked about comparison to others. So if you're living your dream and if you're going after your dream, not comparing it to what others are doing. I know for myself, the dream that I have, tons of other people are doing it, but I need to work on what God is asking me to do right now. And whenever He happens to bring that increase or bring that specific role that I desire, the specific thing that I desire, then that's up to Him. Yeah. I can't compare to people that are already there. So I think those are a couple of things to be thinking about when you're thinking about whether or not your priorities are straight and if they're in line with what God has asked you to do.
Right. And those are episode 45 with Brashana Miller, and then episode 47 with Mara Ansa, if you want to scroll back.
You always have my back. I love it.
I like to mention the numbers in case somebody wants to go find it really easily.
I so appreciate that because I don't remember them.
No, I have to look at my app. That's how I do it.
Yes, you're great. So. I appreciate that. Thank you.
All right. So another thing that you might need to evaluate is whether you have been staying consistent with your time with God. And again, this kind of goes back to that spiritual wellness that we talked about in episode 48, I believe it was, where we are really believe that staying connected to God on an ongoing basis, having that daily habit of spending time with Him can make just a huge difference in your overall health. Mm-hmm. And so I know for me, this week, when I was feeling off, when things were not going well, when I made that big mistake and all the different feelings I had around that, when I kind of looked at my past few days of what my time with God had looked like, I realized I was really not being as committed to that as I would like to be. And again, this is not about like a legalism or rules that you have to spend X amount of time. But I know for me, when I do spend that time where it's not rushed and I'm able to have time to pray and read God's word, I handle the day better. You know, it's just a fact.
Yeah.
And so again, I had to evaluate where I was at with that and realized that probably played a role in my responses to other situations in my day.
Yeah. So I agree. And for me, I think that it kind of comes down to a sort of question that I ask myself, like, where am I getting the power to do what I need to do? That sort of power to do the things that he's called you to do, you can't do it in your own power. And so having a daily time to really talk with God, and for me, I feel like I have to check myself very often on what I'm thinking, the thoughts that I am thinking about what I need to do. Like, are they actually what he wants me to be thinking? Are they right? And so I need to be in God's word and letting the Holy Spirit speak through his word to my mind and to my heart, renewing my mind and checking my heart on a constant basis, because oftentimes, 99% of the time, I try to do stuff in my own power, I feel like. And it ends me up in the place where I felt like I was this past week.
Yeah.
And I don't want to do that again. Mm-hmm. It wasn't fun. And, you know, I talked about this in a previous episode when I felt like, okay, this is really not in a good place. I was like, okay, I asked myself this question, have I been spending time with God? And I hadn't. And I sat down and I started back on the Bible study that I had been working on. And I looked in my prayer journal and I hadn't written in it since February. And I was like, are you kidding me? This is ridiculous. Like, I have done studies and stuff, but I haven't actually written in my prayer journal. And I was just so frustrated with myself and just kind of like, well, that is exactly why you're here. So yeah, that's why you're in this place. So it took me just remembering that and making myself do it, because it's not about feelings.
Yeah.
And so.
Yeah. And some of this is about, I mean, it goes back again to creating habits, and that takes, it takes discipline. It takes hard work. And it's, again, it's habits that we know will end up benefiting us in the long run.
Yeah.
And helping us to be in a better place when we do get to those situations that are hard and we feel like giving up. Mm-hmm. But if we've been in that habit of being with God, it's going to be easier to get through that situation.
Yeah.
So another thing that I think we can evaluate is, you know, are there actually some real life circumstances that might be causing you to feel this way? So just an example in my recent months is that I think I shared on the podcast, if not, I shared in my email list that my dog passed away in April, and it was very sudden and very heartbreaking. And even though he had been sick, I really had a hard time with that. And so when I think about the past month or so, it's been a little over a month now, but I still have to realize that some of the things that I'm dealing with may still be grief. Like, I may still be experiencing grief from that loss, and that's normal. And I have to give myself a break to just like realize, okay, the reason you just reacted that way might actually not be about that thing, you know?
Yeah. And I think a thing to remember about grief is that sometimes it pops up in ways you never even think that it would. I know that when I was going through a lot of the grief that I had to deal with from our infertility journey, I mean, it would be a year or two later and I would still be thinking about it. Stuff would pop up that I didn't even realize until I sort of processed it afterwards. And when I looked at how I had been acting and sort of the things I had been thinking and how I had been feeling, it was definitely all related to that grief that I didn't realize was sort of manifesting itself again.
Yeah.
In my mind and in my heart. And so if you have experienced grief over something, give yourself that grace and be looking out for those things to pop up later on, and give yourself the grace and the mercy to be able to work through it. Don't just push it aside and say, well, that was 2 years ago, or that was, you know, however long ago. Do the work to actually get through it, and don't be discouraged, because that is just the nature of grief. It's random, and sometimes it lasts for a very, very long time. And so sometimes that can make you feel like you want to quit things. So
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So a couple other things that we might experience and that might impact our sense of wanting to quit is family tensions. I mean, we've talked about before, relationships, especially your closest relationships, have a huge impact on your ability to lead, your ability to just function at your best. And yeah. if you're having an ongoing tension, like you said, it doesn't have to be parenting. It doesn't have to be marriage. It could be a sibling. It could be a parent. It could be a, you know, another close relationship. But if there's tension there and there's an ongoing conflict, that is going to be hard. And mm-hmm. so it's just normal to acknowledge this is a hard situation and it's not going away right now. And so it's going to impact my other areas of life.
Yeah. I think another area that might cause you to feel like you want to quit is an illness. Sometimes it's a short-lived illness that just kind of piles on to the other things that you are already dealing with that may cause you to feel this way. But sometimes it can be a long-term chronic illness that you either never saw coming or, you know, just kind of has taken hold of your whole life and can really feel all-consuming and sort of makes you have to reevaluate and retool everything that you're doing so that you can make space and make room for the illness and how you have to journey through that. So yeah. that's definitely something that you want to give yourself a lot of grace. And honestly, there's also grief there because you are grieving either something that you can't do anymore or a way of life or maybe a dream that you had for yourself. So not only are you dealing with sort of a daily new reality, you're also dealing with grief over what you may have lost. Mm-hmm. So yeah. another one that has been a big one for me, and if you've been listening to the podcast, you've heard me talk about it. Our family did a really big move last year from Maine to Florida, and honestly, I hate that I even have to say this, but I'm still reeling from that. And I haven't figured out a new support system. I haven't really felt like we've been able to settle in a really good way. And I think that I took for granted the support system that I had, maybe not in a way that I abused it, but I guess I didn't realize just how big of a support system that I had when I was at home. Yeah. And having to make those connections with people more intentionally, like I don't just see Esther at the corner store or at church on Sunday. You know, I have to call her, I have to Voxer her, I have to, you know, Facebook message her, I have to make an intentional decision to involve her in my life still. And that's not easy for me. I'm not great at that. And so if you've encountered a big move, maybe it's not like a physical family, a whole family move, maybe it's a job move, or maybe it is a ministry move, it can have the same impact and the yeah. same sort of feelings for you. So
absolutely. Yeah. And another kind of real life situation that you might be dealing with and you might want to evaluate is just if you are in business or in a workplace situation, there could be an actual client or customer or coworker where there is actually a problem there and there is a tension. And again, it may not be something that's easily fixed or easily resolved. And so that could be impacting just your overall sense of why you know, want to quit or not keep going. And then another example is, again, referring back to my error that I made on the podcast, the real life circumstance there that I realized was that I'm doing too many things. Like I had a team member who had stepped back from working on my team, on my business team in January. And I kind of took over doing some of the stuff she had been doing. And I hadn't yet handed off anything that I should have. And so I realized she hadn't been doing editing, but she had been doing other things. So then I was now still doing the editing and then also doing other things in my business that previously someone else was doing. And so this was a signal. The fact that I made some mistakes was a signal to me like, mm-hmm. okay, time to find some solutions, right? Time to figure out yeah. offboard, outsource some of these things. Mm-hmm. So we mentioned this before, but another thing that we sometimes need to do when we are evaluating is get perspective from someone else. So again, with my situation with Holly, I was able to tell her how I was feeling, and then she was able to speak truth over me so I didn't get sucked into my own head and my own thoughts. And that really made a difference. So sometimes with evaluating, you actually need a different person's perspective because we yeah. are not always the best evaluators of our own circumstance.
Yeah, you know? Oh, definitely.
So we often need outside perspective.
Yeah.
So what's something else we should evaluate?
A few more things that we'll mention, and then we'll move on to our next point. But you might want to reevaluate your foundation. So what is your actual life mission? And is the thing that you want to quit, does it deviate away from that? Maybe that is why you feel like you want to quit. So what is the mission that God has given you? What is the vision for the future? And is the thing that is causing you to feel this way, is it a deviant from that? Is it not actually helping you get to that vision? And then are you compromising your values? Perhaps it's a situation in a workplace or a way that you've sort of a habit you've gotten into in your business or something like that that's actually compromising your values and has caused you to sort of lose your passion or lose your sense of motivation over that. That can be very discouraging as you're going through it if what you're doing or maybe what you're saying or how you're acting out really compromises your values. So it's really important to look at your foundation and see if either what you're doing deviates from what you already know to be true about your foundation, or if your foundation, like your vision, your mission, your values need to be changed or tweaked in some way.
Yeah.
The other thing about sort of your foundation is self-awareness. And I think that that is really important, especially for me as I grow older and start to learn more about myself. When I look at my personality and my gifting, if I am expecting something different or something that's sort of super generic, it may not actually fit me and my personality and my gifting. And I think that that is part of your foundation. I think your mission and your vision and your values should reflect or have some sort of nod to your personality and your gifting.
Yeah.
And should kind of take into consideration those things as you go forward. So it's really important to be considering your foundation when you're feeling like this.
Yeah. And we talked about that in episode 8 and episode 10. So this episode is going to have a lot of links to other episodes because we talk about self-awareness in episode 8. And then in episode 10, we talked about finding your purpose. And that was a really good conversation related to this whole issue of gifts and your personality and how those play into the issue of purpose, which again, we go into a lot more depth in that conversation. So I just want to mention those.
Yeah. And so the final little thing, which we've already sort of touched on and talked about, is are you doing what God told you to do? So sometimes that's a really easy question to answer. It's a yes or it's a no. And sometimes it's a little bit more difficult to answer. And I actually, this week in my Bible reading, I read 2 Corinthians 4. And so if you have a minute and you can read that entire chapter, it's a really great chapter. But it starts off this way. In verse 1, therefore, since God in his mercy has given us this new way or has given us this ministry, we never give up. And so if you're not doing what God has told you to do and you're not doing the ministry that he's given you, you probably feel like you want to give up. I love this chapter, and I'm going to reference it a couple more times throughout the episode. But at the very beginning, it says, because he's given us this ministry, we never give up. And at the very end, it says, and these are all the reasons why we don't give up. And in the middle, it talks all about the gospel and the ministry and how we need to be keeping it sort of the forefront of our minds and how we sort of go about doing that. But
yeah. And I love that too, because another way of saying we don't give up in a different translation is we do not lose heart. And I think sometimes it's like, man, I'm losing heart. I'm losing hope.
Yeah.
And that's where you start to get in that mode of, I'm just going to throw in the towel because nothing I'm doing is making a difference. Mm. And so I just love that reminder that if we're doing what God has called us to do and we're in the place where we're supposed to be, which a lot of times is just where we are. It's not in some fancy situation. It might just be you're being a mom, you're being a wife, you're being a coworker, you're being a friend. And that's what God has called you to. And giving up is not what God wants us to do in those scenarios. Hi, friend. I'm jumping into this episode to let you know some fun news. The Confident Leader Club is going to be open to join around the end of June. If you're looking for a way to connect with like-minded women who understand how lonely leadership can be,
if you want to grow and broaden your skills as a leader, and if you're looking for accountability to take action on your big goals, then I want to invite you to get on the waitlist now. Those of you on the waitlist will have the first chance to jump in when the doors open again. You don't have to lead alone, and the Confident Leader Club will provide you with the community you've been looking for. Head over to confidentleaderclub.com to get on the waitlist now. Now let's jump back into the episode. Our second point, though, so we talked about evaluate, so that's the first point. So the second point is actually give up. But that sounds a little ridiculous, especially after what we just said. But let me try to explain what I mean by that. I mean, don't quit what you're doing, but give up control. Mm-hmm. Right? And this, I'm preaching to myself right now.
Yep.
Give it over to God. And again, we talk about this in episode 36, Ditching Balance for Surrender. This idea that rather than trying to do everything and do it all really, really well, sometimes we just need to surrender to God. And we have to acknowledge that we actually can't do everything mm-hmm. that we're supposed to do on our own, like in our own power, like what you were referring to earlier. We have to be relying on the power from God and not of ourselves to do all of this. And then secondly with that is to stop trying to do all the things perfectly. And again, this is where I tend to roll. I try to do everything really, really well. And I mean, one of my core values in my business is excellence, because I really feel strongly that I think that whenever possible, we should do things well, you know, and do things for the glory of God.
Yep.
And I think there's value in that, but it doesn't mean do things perfectly. And it doesn't mean that I'm not going to make mistakes, you know, like I did with the podcast. Like I made a mistake. I can't do everything perfectly. And it's not reality for me to hold myself to that standard.
Yeah. So I feel like the next one that's important to talk about is to give up criticizing yourself, giving yourself more grace, especially if the reality check you did earlier helped you recognize some real reasons that you might be feeling this way. Perhaps you need to give yourself some time or space to deal with those emotions. So give up criticizing yourself that you haven't met expectations or that you haven't done what you thought you should do or that life didn't turn out how you wanted it, and instead give yourself some grace and give yourself some time and space to deal with those emotions.
I think we also need to give up thinking that life is supposed to be happy and wonderful all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Because suffering is part of life. Hard stuff happens. Like we talked about earlier, grief happens, and it's weird, and it's not something you can really control, and life isn't perfect. And I think sometimes we have this expectation, again, being in, like, for those of us who are in the United States in this very affluent culture, there's an expectation or desire to just have things be happy and wonderful all the time. And it's just not that way. And so I think we need to give up that expectation or that desire and recognize that sometimes things are hard and it's okay to be sad. It's okay to struggle. And it's even okay to feel like throwing in the towel. You know, I mean, it's okay to feel that way. We don't want to stay in that place forever, but sometimes we just need to give up that sense of everything should be perfect and happy all the time.
Yeah. I think another one that I've talked about lots of times is that we need to give up being driven by our emotions. I have to give myself more regular reality checks about what I'm actually saying to myself. And sometimes I need to trust someone else to tell me what's actually real, what's really happening. There's a saying, perception is reality. And so whatever I think is happening, whatever my feelings are telling me, I think is reality. And so I operate based on that reality that I've constructed with my emotions. And sometimes I need someone else to say to me, hey, you realize that you're kind of making some of that up in your head, right?
You mean like what you did to me the other day?
Yes. And what you have done for me lots of times. Yeah. So it's really important to kind of be aware of that and be aware of how your emotions are driving you.
Yeah.
And one verse from 2 Corinthians 4 that I think definitely goes with this is 2 Corinthians 4:7. We have this light shining in our hearts, but we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing the great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. And for me, this just says we need to give up thinking that we're invincible and thinking that we have to give off that view to other people that we are invincible and that we can truly do all the things. The whole point in all of this is that we are to show God's glory. And when we show that we are in fact fragile jars of clay, we just give more glory to the great treasure that is God's great power. And so I really loved that reminder, because a lot of the things that we hear in our society today is you can do it, be invincible, be fierce, be all these things. What the Bible is really telling us is that we are like fragile jars of clay. And when I think about that, even the smallest little sort of vibration or just a small hit can cause them to crack and break. Yeah. And so when we think about ourselves that way, it reminds us that the power that we have is really what we need to be relying on. And that's the power of God.
Mm, yeah.
Yeah.
And it makes such a difference when people see you go through a difficult time and get through it, but they may see you struggle, but they see you turning to God. And yeah. I mean, that can be such a testimony to people. I think that people who struggle with Christians often struggle most with the people who have that air of perfection and yeah. self-righteousness and seem to just always have something to say about how everyone is messing everything up and they're perfect, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, that's just not reality. I think, I mean, we've gotten feedback on our podcast just that people appreciate that we're down to earth and that we are real. And I think we're not trying to, again, I think there's a line there of glorifying our sin or glorifying our weaknesses. That's not good either. But
right.
recognizing that, yeah, we have to have God's power to accomplish anything that He's asked us to do.
Yeah.
And just to get through life.
So yeah, I actually recently wrote a blog post about this, and we can link it in the show notes. But it's, I just talked about how oftentimes we try to, in leadership, show this like sort of our best foot forward. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. But I talked about leading with our scars and how truly transformative that can be when we have gone through something and God has healed us and we are willing to show those scars and willing to say, to sort of point to those times in our life where we have allowed God to heal us, and we say to other people, He can do that for you. Look at this scar, that it reminds me of not just the wound that happened, but look at how the great care He took with my heart and the great gentleness and kindness and love, and He can do that for you too. So yeah, it just kind of makes me think about that and how important it is to appropriately and with discernment share those things with people yeah. that you're leading and that are around you. And I talk a little bit about that as well in the blog post about when it's appropriate and yeah. that sort of thing. So
that's awesome. I'm excited to share that with everybody. All right. So the third thing that we want to encourage you to do when you feel like quitting, after you've evaluated and after you have given up some things, In the right context, is to make a plan. So, you know, make a plan for how you're going to move forward, because there might actually be things that you need to quit. So mm-hmm. ask yourself, what can I actually quit? Will the world fall apart if I stop doing XYZ? And I think this can be an issue too of pride and of thinking that I have to keep doing all these things, because if I don't do them, no one else is going to do them the right way. I mean, yeah. that's a common, I mean, as leaders, often we tend to be the people who just get stuff done and just move things forward. Mm-hmm. And it can be hard to let go of doing certain things because we think if we don't do them, that something is not going to happen. And so it goes back to trusting God, trusting that God is actually the one blessing the work, blessing the ministry, you know, the business, whatever it might be, and mm-hmm. that there might actually be things that you need to give up and stop doing. And that might give someone else the opportunity to step in.
Yeah.
And again, it goes back to the priorities thing, right? What are yeah. the actual priorities that you have in your life? And those should be the areas where you're focusing your time and energy.
Yeah. And I feel like for me, whenever I do that, it really helps me easily kind of weed out the stuff that should be gone. Not that I'm not caring about those things, and not that it might not be difficult to get rid of them, but when I really am focusing on that and I can really see the value in why God has given those top few things to me, then it's easy to go, okay, well, I can see how this doesn't serve what he is asking me to do. And, you know, like you said, someone else might need the opportunity to step into whatever that is.
Yeah.
So
absolutely. Sometimes you can also just, besides just quitting things, you can outsource or delegate things that you can't quit. Like they still need to happen. Mm-hmm. But someone else could do them. So just a couple examples of that, if we're thinking about household things, is housework. Like other people besides you may be able to do mm-hmm. some of the housework. And they may not do it the same as you. They may not get all the places just the way you like it. But maybe that's an area you could outsource. Maybe it's in your workplace or your business that might be administrative tasks. You know, mm-hmm. little things that you don't have to be the one doing them.
Yeah.
And it could be with the kids. Maybe you need to set up a carpool situation where you can rotate between yourself and a few other moms and take turns. Do you have to be the person picking up your kid every day? Now, I know some people that prioritize that because that time in the car with their kids is a really important time to them and they get a lot of good conversations. So again, this is not about prescribing what you should do, but just thinking about some options.
Yeah.
For outsourcing. And in my situation, I'm going to outsource the editing because I've recognized it's time.
Okay. I think the other thing that you can do as far as making a plan is ask yourself, what habits need to change? Do I need to create new habits? Do I need to shuffle things around? Do I need to get rid of some of the bad habits? Maybe it's a bad habit that's actually causing or contributing to this feeling of wanting to quit. And that is definitely something that has happened to me this past week. I have a habit, or I don't know, body clock, whatever. I am not a morning person. Not like grumpy. I look sort of drunk and like, I just am nasty. I'm not a pleasant person in the morning. And so my husband is away this past week. So I had to bring my son to school, and he likes to be there at the very first moment that he's allowed to arrive at school, not at the very last moment he's allowed to arrive at school, which was me all the way through school. So that means we have to leave our house by like 6:50 or 7 o'clock. And that just doesn't go with my rhythm of I want to be. Yeah, that's early. And so I have been finding I had created a bad habit of coming back home and getting back in bed for an hour. And I realized that it was making it hard for me to get up after I laid back down. It was making it hard for me to get any sort of motivation. It took me way longer to actually get to my computer. It took me way longer to actually get to things I needed to actually do. And it was a bad habit that I needed to change. So mm-hmm. after I kind of talked to Esther and confessed my terrible habit, I was like, you know what? This week, I'm not going to lay back down. And I will confess to you that I laid back down this morning for a little bit, but all the other mornings I didn't. And I felt so, so much better. Yeah. And it's so quick. It's so interesting how quick you can fall into a habit and mm-hmm. how much you don't realize that it's affecting you. Yeah. I was kind of allowing myself to be lazy because I was pitying myself that I had to actually get up that early.
Yeah.
Instead of just accepting it and sort of using it as, okay, I'm going to get a couple extra hours of work this week. That's great. Or maybe I can take a more leisurely morning or whatever it is. Instead of sort of seizing that and making it positive, I was pitying myself and therefore fell into a bad habit. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah. And to go back to the wellness thing, when we talked about in episode 48 about physical wellness, I mean, one of the areas is sleep. Like mm-hmm. actually getting enough sleep for our bodies mm-hmm. makes a huge impact on in how our emotions and how our thoughts work. And so the habits, like we're talking about, I mean, sometimes the habit might be related to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
For you, you know, you needed to stay up so that you would go to bed earlier.
Yep.
For me, mm-hmm. I have the habit of staying up too late. And so that's one of my habits I need to change is
going to bed earlier because I know that getting to bed earlier will help me, because I get up at the same time pretty much every day, but it's, if I go to bed later, then I'm getting less sleep and that's not
right
for me. So in terms of making a plan, I think just creating a daily routine that fits your personality and your real life, but also taking into account that sometimes it means making some hard decisions and making your health yourself have some accountability, you know, doing some sort of system with your friend, or, you know, some of us in the Confident Leader Club, sometimes we have some accountability going on in there about how we, you know, are working on particular habits, and that can really make an impact in how we can move forward.
Yeah.
So as we kind of wrap up this conversation, we just want to hit on a couple summary points. So in general, if you feel like quitting, you might actually need to quit something. That might be the case. Or you might just need to give up control, give up some of those things that we talked about. And also what we talked about in episode 50 is there might be times where you need to seek some professional support. And again, we talked about that when we talked about personal wellness. We are not mental health experts. So there are times when this might be actually a mental health issue and you might need some additional support. If you're truly struggling with depression or other things going on, you may need more than just these steps that we've given you today.
Yeah.
So is there anything else you think that we kind of need to just keep in mind as we summarize this conversation?
Yeah. So I'm going to give you that end cap of 2 Corinthians 4. And it's basically just saying, like, if you know what God has called you to do, then don't give up on it. So 2 Corinthians 4, 16 through 18 says, "This is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long, yet produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things that we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever." And so I just wanted to kind of end on that as an encouragement to you that sometimes the things that we are dealing with and the reasons that we want to quit feel super big and feel like they won't ever change. But as we can see from what the Bible tells us, that they are small when we consider the in light of eternity, and they are not going to last for very long. And so if we press on and we continue, those things are going to produce for us glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So it's kind of shifting our focus from the temporary to the eternal. And so I just hope that that encourages you, because when I read that, it was really encouraging to me.
Yeah. It's such a good note to end on, because if you actually look at Paul, who wrote this book, the experiences that he had seem pretty drastic, you know, shipwrecks, being beaten, so many things, so many times, things that most of us will never experience in our lives, right?
Yeah.
It's and so for him to say that those things were small and won't last very long, you know, that's just like a reminder to me to be like, okay, Esther, maybe this podcast error that you made is not that big of a deal.
Mm-hmm.
But again, just to keep in mind that our power comes from God, and that's how we're going to keep going in our life, in our ministry, in our work, whatever we're doing.
Yeah.
So,
if you take one thing away, that's the thing we want you to take away from this episode. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. All right. So time for our question of the day.
Okay,
what do you have today?
I'll ask you, what is the worst exotic food you've ever had in another country, and what is the best?
Oh, okay. Whew. All right. So mine is really weird. It's not, it does not sound that exotic or weird or like gross, but let me explain it. So I was in Honduras, and this was in college. I went on a missions trip, and we were working in a banana plantation. Like, we were out in the middle of these huge banana fields and working at a church. And so one day for lunch, they were bringing out lunch for us. And I mean, there were some weird things that I ate, but I'm pretty open to trying different kinds of foods. And so one day they said, "Oh, we're going to have boiled bananas. Do you want to try some?" And I was like, "Sure. I like bananas. Why not?"
It was like totally an optional thing. Like it wasn't one of those times where if I had turned it down, I would have been offending someone. I tried them and they were so gross, like boiled banana. It takes out all the flavor and it's just pure starch and it's awful. And so that I would say is probably the worst. Again, it doesn't sound that exotic, but definitely not something I want to have again. So as far as the best, goodness, I am really bad at choosing the best because, again, I like a lot of things. Mm-hmm. I would say probably some of the meals I've had in Guatemala have been some of the best when they actually make Guatemalan food, not when they make American food.
Right. Agreed.
So probably some kind of chicken dish with like some special sauce. I don't remember a specific meal that was the best, but
yeah,
I would say probably there. What about you? What's the worst that you've had?
So when we went to, we were on a trip together. Okay. The time we went to Guatemala and we were in that village that took forever to get to. And it was the one where all the kids came running towards us. Mm-hmm. When we arrived in the village, we sat down under this canopy thing to have lunch. Yes. And they served us hen. Mm-hmm. You remember this?
Yes.
And some sort of root vegetable.
Yeah.
It looked like a potato. And it tasted terrible. I was going to equate it to something, but I think that would be rude. So it was just bad. And I don't know what the difference between hen and chicken is. Like,
yeah,
there is a difference. It was nasty. It was not good. Mm. I did not like it. And it's so terrible to say because these people worked so hard to prepare us this meal and they gave us the best that they had.
Yeah.
And so I should never say that, but oh my gosh, I'll be very happy to not ever eat that again. And I wish I knew the name of that root food.
It's so like on the tip of my tongue, but I can't remember it, but it probably tasted a lot like boiled bananas.
It was not good. And I was like, oh gosh, okay. A root vegetable, you know, I grew up in potato country. I can handle this, you know? Mm-hmm. And then No.
Okay. What about the best? What's the best?
Okay. So my absolute favorite thing that I think we did on our first trip to Guatemala, I don't think we did it on our second trip, was the pastor that we were with went to the market and bought all kinds of exotic fruits and brought us back a tasting of fruits that we had never had before. And so first of all, I just loved that because I love fruit and it was super yummy. But my favorite was a fruit called the rambutan. And it looks like, I don't know, it's a small ball, I guess, that kind of fits in the palm of your hand, but it has all these really long hairs on the outside of it. And it's kind of like strawberry colored, but like brownish. And you peel that outside off. And then on the inside, it's like clearish white, kind of looks like a green grape that's been peeled. And then on the inside, it has a pit that looks very much like an almond. So, okay, I've described all those things, but it tastes so, is probably the best fruit I've ever had in my life. And probably 5 or 6 years ago, we were traveling in Maine and we went to a Whole Foods and they had them. And I bought like an armload of them, even though they were insanely expensive. Yeah. Yeah. And tasted them. They did not even taste anywhere near close to what they tasted like in Guatemala, but it was enough to remind me.
Yeah.
And it was, so every time, anytime I go back, which hasn't been very often, but hopefully more often, I ask for them because they are so, so yummy. If you ever go to a Central American country and have someone that knows how to prepare it, you ask for a fruit because their fruit tastes nothing like our fruit.
Oh my word. That is 100% true. I mean, I was just thinking about that in regards to pineapple because I had fresh pineapple in Costa Rica and that is like the most delicious thing ever. And it's
it'll blow not your mind.
The same as the pineapple that we get here in the stores.
Absolutely. It's not there.
Different when there's not a pineapple plantation right down the street.
Oh, well, and we have to say that the coffee is second to none.
Oh, yes, coffee.
I personally feel like the coffee in Guatemala is just, and I don't like coffee. Like, I just don't like it. But
that's where when I lived in Costa Rica for a semester, that's when I fell in love with coffee.
Yeah.
I didn't really care about coffee before, but I fell in love with it then and started drinking it every day.
Yeah. So good.
Yep.
But here, ugh,
No, I disagree. I still drink it here, but it's not okay. The same.
No.
Oh, so, okay. So again, in our Facebook group, we are going to ask this question. The week that this podcast episode comes out, we'll ask this question and we want to hear your answers too. So, and it doesn't have to be in another country. Maybe you've just had a weird thing here in the US. That's fine.
Yeah.
Or wherever you live, you might not live in the US. So we'll be asking that and you can tell us. So thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for joining us on the Christian Woman Leadership Podcast. If you're looking for additional support, growth, and accountability to take action, I would love to invite you to check out the Confident Leader Club. We only open the doors a few times a year, so you can jump on the wait list right now so that you're the first to know when the doors open. Or if we happen to be open when you're listening, you'll be able to join right away. I can't wait to see you on the inside. Now, don't forget, your leadership matters, and it's time for you to embrace your gifts and lead with confidence.